So I am on my way to Grand Prix Vegas. This is probably going to be the last Grand Prix that I play for this season because I already have 5 finishes, and the only way like it will be relevant in any way in terms of me trying to hit platinum would be if I top 8 at a Grand Prix. So, you know, given that that's incredibly difficult to do, it's just really, really hard for me to actually justify going to an East Coast Grand Prix to try to chase a few extra pro points. So, you know, Vegas is going to be fun. You know, it's one of those places where even if you don't do bad, even if you don't do well, you can still have a good time. Much needed vacation. I haven't really traveled to any tournaments for a long time, so this should be really fun. Going to be meeting up with a lot of friends, and this will also be the weekend of my 30th birthday. I don't want to say that out too loudly here, but yes, I'm going to be turning 30. My back's hurting, turning into an old man, got a baby, but it should be good times. So I arrived at the Vegas airport, and apparently Mr. John Stocks has provided a driver for us. So we are doing Vegas in style. I'm very hungry. Taking care of the Hungry Hungry Cheons. So, yeah, just arrived. I've already mapped out my next few days and even a fail-safe plan if I don't make day 2, so it should be good times. And apparently also getting picked up in a limo. No big deal. This is gonna be a fun trip. I'm also going to be very broke. See, I got you in the picture now. Thank you, Angela.
It's a good thing Julia's
watching. Man, you know, my decision making at the draft table might be questionable, but my decision making and picking friends to room with, incomparable. Look at this. We are in the Caesars room, and this is a suite. Not only is it suite, it is actually a suite. I mean, this thing is huge. And if you look at the table, boom, 3v3 drafts? So this is meal number 1. Lotus of Siam was unfortunately closed because we came in at 3 o'clock. So we're gonna go there at another date, but this is for 2 people. We have, I don't even know how to explain this. Freshly shaved pork, guacamole, cheese, sour cream, green sauce, fries, and then 6 tacos each, or whatever. What are these things called?
Molas.
What are molas?
They're like a taco with a cheese grilled on the inside.
Oh my goodness, it's like a quesadilla taco. Oh. Okay, entering the site for Grand Prix Vegas after our gigantic meal where we just ordered way too much food.
You ordered way too much food.
You ordered the food, I was in the restroom. Yeah, all right. Can't just lie. And here we are, GP Vegas. This is Thursday too, by the way, guys. There's like nothing happened. You know, the GP doesn't start till Saturday, but everybody wants to make magic history. And there's gonna be 2 GPs basically in the same spot. Although, I don't know if this is the main area because they said that it would take you 10 minutes to get from one side to the other. And I don't feel like that's true, right? It'll take you like 5 minutes. But the hype.
Pretty big room, but it could be over there.
I will accept just opening a foil tournament wife and winning the GP. Like, I'll accept that. Any less would be a massive disappointment. So, caught up with the rest of the Channel Fireball gang. So if you look, what is... Look.
Well, no, I'm not trying to make fun of you.
So, apparently he played basketball earlier today. That's what Ben said, and he did not look like this.
Look like what, Paul?
This is ridiculous. Like, what is this? I've not been around for this before, but yeah, this is... What was it that Geneva said earlier?
The mustache has to stay in Vegas.
Geneva's very...
Oh yeah, that took a lot of sophistication.
The mustache didn't look bad when he had the full thing going.
No, the full beard looked good. I mean, people like the beard.
I guess the mustache like plus glasses combination. It really looks
yeah.
Good.
Yeah. Yeah. No, yeah, this is all. To be, this is pretty bad too. This is, come on, man.
This is almost fine.
Mr. Rogers creepy.
Yeah, I totally let my kids be around.
I agree with you.
It's not fun.
You cannot spend time with Kyle with that getup.
You're just jealous because you can't grow a sweet mustache.
The what?
You're just jealous because you can't grow a sweet mustache.
Can you actually not grow a mustache?
I don't know. I haven't tried, but so I would never have it look like that.
I would kill to not be able to grow facial hair.
You would kill to what?
Not be able to grow any facial hair. Just to never have to shave.
You shave, right?
Yeah, I shave every day.
Every day?
Yeah.
So just never have to shave and always be clean shaven? Sounds amazing.
To be fair, you'd pay $100,000 for internet on the internet.
$100,000
international Wi-Fi.
It's coming, apparently.
Yeah, you paid
how
enough.
How much would you pay to know how much you pay? I don't know. I mean, a substantial
he said he would
amount
kill a
probably
person.
Not crazy. Like,
what?
You choose any person.
A person who's just...
So here we are doing the bounty event. And of course, Lucky Shahar opens... What is that card over there? Hiding in the corner?
I don't know.
Let's just...
And
oh, hey!
Elshir, too.
Oh. It looks like Paulo over there is also running as hot as the sun, opened the Tarmogoyf as well.
Paulo.
How lucky. Wait, did you open another one?
Elshinorn, but not as good.
Jeez.
That's not bad.
I opened no money rares.
You got Thief of Hope.
I have it. Alright. This logs. Okay.
You can try to go jump them off on whoever's down
there. I'll jump it off. Alright, so this is the first seal pull that we have for bounty event number one. Not particularly happy with it. It's just blue, black, mediocre. You know, the things that it has going for it is the fact that it's got a lot of removal. You've got a couple of Agony Warps, an Aimless Immersion, Ghost Splitter, Narcolepsy, a couple of Grim Afflictions, and Stoic Rebuttal. Stoic Rebuttal is actually, you know, I'm not the biggest fan of the card, but there are a lot of bombs here. And it does interact well with all of my instant speed removals. It's like, you know, if they play around counter, I could just kill their guys. Then we have the minor little combos here, Plague Rusalka, Double Skeleton with Mortar Pod. And the rares that I opened were Spell's Guide, Eldrazi Temple, and Eldrazi Eye of Ugin. Not a whole lot of good stuff, but I did open a Mold Drifter, and I decided to play this Ulamog's Crusher, because otherwise our deck cannot win. So, managed to take over, take the first one, but we've got to protect our packs. China Fireball's packs. Oh, wow. So this is the Vegas trip. On my way into the Venetian Hotel. We are going to eat at Mario Batali's Carne Vino. In celebration of Old Man Cheon's 30th birthday. So hopefully I'm going the right way, but really, really excited. It's 10:30 because we had to play the bounty event and it went pretty late, but still hungry, haven't eaten since like 2, so. Whew. Let's have some fun. So here we are at Carne Vino, and this is the infamous Reserva steak. Aged for 6 months, we're all splitting it. No, people are sharing it. What the hell?
Paul.
That's like really nice, expensive, fancy steak, and that's how you're eating it?
How else would you eat it?
I guess it goes with the stash. But yeah, this is nice. It is now midnight, so it's actually officially my birthday. As we get our steaks, but look at that thing. Is that 1 or 2 inches right here? Is this all of it?
Two.
Okay.
It's gonna be a good game for this bill.
Alright, so here we are eating at Bacchanal. The food? Oh, I don't know what food it is. We are going through these plates like wildfire. Mm. That's my tiny little piece of prime rib, or brisket actually. Some linguica, mac and cheese, cream corn, here going on. Probably my only meal of the day. Actually, no, that's just a lie. Well, that hand you saw was Eirik taking a salmon off my plate, but this is gonna be plate number 4, and then we're gonna head on to dessert after, probably. All right, I promise, no more food pictures. But wait! yeah. So, our plan is to just get a million things and just split it. There's also ice cream, but we don't need to share that one, right? We can all just get our own ice cream. It's all good. It's all good.
This bounty ran a lot better than the one yesterday, so...
Yeah. We are on our way to...
Both bounties I played in the bigger than the first Grand Prix.
Channel Fireball meet and greet.
Paul.
What is it, Luis? No, you, like something? Maybe just like...
Just in general?
Yeah, like did you need something or... No? Nothing? You're not even turning around this time. Just continue to walk. Right. Looks like we are being greeted by Elvis. Where are we supposed to go? This way?
Right there, man.
Alrighty. Okay. Ooh, food.
Smell.
And that's the magic TV area back there.
Do we sit somewhere?
Get food.
I do want food for everything.
Oh, no problem.
Pasta station. Sign me up. About to start magic TV. Are we starting? We have Mashi. Nobody ever sees the actual coverage, guys, but they're right there. Avi's not even working, he's just texting. Are we? And boom, this is the Platinum VIP room, look. There we go.
Paul,
am I what?
Paul, who are you even talking to?
Talking to myself? This is.
Yes, you are talking to yourself. Very good, that's all I wanted. I'm talking to myself.
None of this is going on the internet. All right. So it looks like we have over 440 platinum planeswalkers who have, you know, basically signed up for the full pack. Can I explain?
What do you want to explain?
I'm trying to explain what a platinum planeswalker is, and I just keep getting.
You need to see your license registration.
Are you kidding me?
I'm gonna see your Cheon ranking card.
Please tell us more about.
Sorry, this Cheon ranking card is too low. You're in a restricted area.
There's really, at this point, I can't even say anything. This you just, what?
Paul.
Much smaller, you put many fewer people. I mean, it just seems like it's kind of a PR no-brainer. Yeah. On the other hand, I mean, we're biased here. I don't know why they decided to come on and pre-print all these cards with new art. I mean, I think that nobody actually thinks that's a good idea, except for one person on the flavor committee there decided it's a new world, so it's not the same. This is the answer I was given back when, you know, Chris, I think, was reprinted for the first time with different art.
Yeah,
I know he's got two different articles. A totally unbiased version here, John, from people saying, why did he change the art on the channel page? Yeah, I mean, to be honest, by the time it came to channel page, I was already ready for it. You know, I was more, you know, pissed off than they did to Chris, now they did to Bob, but then at that point, you just realize that this is what's going to happen, and it's probably going to come to me someday. And I'm still very happy to have my card. I guess I'm slightly happier that it got reprinted with different art than not getting reprinted at all.
But going back into the days of yore, one of the moments at an invitational, you were matched up against Ben Rippon. This was a moment where I was like, okay, so these guys do make the same stupid mistakes I do. And I think he mana leaked one of your spells. Instead of paying it, you dissipated the mana leak. And I remember reading about that, and I was like, there's just no way! How could he do that? And of course, when you're the guy on the left, you dissipate every time. John Finkel, it happens once.
And then yeah, I don't remember that, so I'm going to assume that your memory is mistaken.
This is why we need to be on the screen. If we were live right now, there'd be fact checking going on.
And if there's video evidence, I'm going to assume that it's my camera.
And for any future printing.
Wait, who gave you this? What?
This was from Steven and LSV, it said.
Yep.
That's wait, awesome. Was Luis involved in this?
Thanks for my monkey.
He delivered it.
So it looks like Marshall got a gift from a fan where in the binder is one of every single ape in existence. Ever printed.
One of each copy of each
there's
one.
There's literally, like check this out. There's foil, not foil, foil, like every single print.
That is awesome.
This is one of the greatest gifts I've ever received.
That is absurd. That is insane.
There it is. That's awesome.
That is.
That's a lot of work.
That is a great gift.
I got a note in here too from Steven.
Is he around, you know?
He had to take off, but...
He's got his email here. I'll send him an email.
You can give him a shout-out on the show.
I will do that, too.
Yeah,
he says, thanks for the awesome podcast and all you do for the magic community. I personally have benefited greatly from your wisdom and dedication and couldn't think of a better way to show it. Well, you know, I look forward to more leveling up as a result of your work. I wish you continued success in all you do. Sincerely, Steven. That is awesome. Thank you, Steven. That's great.
The key cards for that are Devour and Greed and Nameless Incursion for Spirits or Smoke Breeder and Lord for Elementals or just the Drazis and the best Scattered Seeds and Scion, just all the good green token making guys. I mean, there's different cards for each archetype. The point is, you really need to be able to get all those
basically all 24 packs in the draft.
Sure.
So if there's two or three different people playing that archetype, all of your decks will usually be bad. And if you're the only one playing that archetype, your deck is usually awesome. So it's very important not to glue yourself to your first deck, to just look for what archetype you're seeing and make that deck.
So in this format, what's more important? Having that like kind of consistent seven or having one of these huge bombs?
Definitely the consistent seven, yeah.
Ben S?
Yeah, the consistent seven.
All right, okay. We're running a lot of time, so I'll get you out on this one. What card would you most like to open tomorrow, Ben S?
I mean, it's what Huey reads at two Karn because it's colorless and it's amazing. I mean, it's not necessarily the most powerful card of the entire set. Common Storm or Elishan are probably actually better than Karn, but you can play Karn in one of your two decks no matter what you open, so it's the best card to open.
Okay, guys, we are about to enter the scene. The Grand Prix, day one. Grand Prix Las Vegas, day one. The largest Grand Prix of all time. There's gonna be like, what we're predicting, like 12 to 15,000 people just walking around. And I think over 8,000 people actually registered, so pretty exciting. We have our suite sleep-in special, so we got to sleep in, which is awesome. Feels great, because the meet and greet went for a while. And let's just take a look and just see how busy this place is. There was a picture of somebody posted a picture of the side events line, and it was like a ride at Disneyland or something. It was unreal. Wow, this is insane. It's like an automobile convention or something. Like, that's how big the size of this place is. Unbelievable. Make magic history, right? You know, I could use a selfie stick for this one. So this is the actual wall. This is a complete list of all the people who are attending Grand Prix Vegas. It is ridiculous. Look at this, this is A through C. A through C. It keeps going. It keeps going. Okay, it stops. Where am I? Baker. Oh my god. I'm the last one on C. Boom, Paul Cheon. Gideon. I'm in the Gideon area. So apparently what they're doing is they're splitting the Grand Prix into two, obviously, because it's 8,000 people. Then they're also splitting the people in the different Grand Prix into different sections under Planeswalker banners to make it a lot easier. But I think because a lot of people didn't know what was going on, the Grand Prix starting 2.5 hours late because, you know, people just had to figure out where they had to be. So, you know, it's currently 11:30 and the Grand Prix is about to start, but I mean, that's... Can you imagine what this place would have looked like, just this area, when 10,000 people or 9,000 people are trying to figure out where to sit? It's just insane. But wow, this is impressive. Look at this. And they put it right by the food too. That's actually just smart. So just finished round four of Grand Prix Las Vegas. I actually just lost the feature match area with Ifro by my side. We both got crushed in this round. I was up a game, and game two I had lethal, and he's like, yeah, I gotta draw a burn spell. And I was like, no burn, lightning bolt. So I lost game two, and then he beat me game three, so I'm down. I'm three and one, so still got five rounds to go. It's probably 7 p.m. right now. I had God knows what time it is. Six?
Four?
So rounds are actually not going
that bad.
4-3. But we still have five more rounds of Magic to play, so it's kind of insane. I actually almost missed this round. So I go to the other side because Luis is like, Paul, come here. I'm like, where are you? 10 minutes away. It's the other side of the hall. So I show up. Then he looks at my deck. Then he's like, yeah, I don't care about your deck. Throws it to the side somewhere. Makes me look at his deck. Then I get like, you know, I have to sign a bunch of things. And then like all of a sudden one of the ladies is like, oh, your round started. So I just run, only to find that I forgot my deck. Fortunately, I had a feature match. So I run back, come back, dripping in sweat, playing my round. You know, I've never been so pumped up, I guess, for a round, but only to lose in heart-crushing defeat. So, still just one loss, got a lot more magic to play. Next round about to start.
Eric, you're up. Super
nice.
six.
Yeah.
Two?
Yep.
Yeah.
Roast Savage Twist.
Alrighty.
That works. That's six.
Oh my god.
Oh wow.
These games have been ridiculous. I needed to land, obviously. Alright, so I was 6-1, lost my feature match. I'm 0-2 in feature matches, but played an insanely tight match in the last round, but I managed to pull it out. I was down a game, and I actually had to top deck a land to Banefire my opponent out to go to game three. And then won an insanely close game three. And I'm just excited to draft some Modern Masters. So 7-2, not like the best record, but just happy to be playing tomorrow. So here we are, the after the day one post, what?
So Charles deck has 1 hour in here and one group.
Anyways,
for Red Man.
This is the dinner after
for Red Man.
Day one of Grand Prix Las Vegas. Luis has the best record.
So incredibly unlucky, it's unbelievable.
So Luis gave me the impression that he did not make day two.
I didn't give you that impression.
I called him, I was like, how did you do? He's like, oh, I lost my last round. And I was like,
that's just factually accurate.
Yeah, I know, that's all true, but it just, the sound of disappointment made it seem like you just got knocked out.
It's like this all the time.
Anyways, literally there's no point in arguing this. Luis and Raptor, 8-1. And then a bunch of us are 7-2. Me, Paulo, Mr. John Stocks. Did we win our win innings? Yeah, we all won our innings, so we feel great. Yeah, yeah. But yeah. So day one in the books, having some Mexican food. In an unusual location. That's all I gotta say. I'm sure some of you guys can figure it out. We're at the El Dorado Cantina. And the thing is, there's like not that much good food. Louis, can you stop? There's not that much good food at the convention place. So, like, can you stop? You're talking about, you know. So yeah, we're just gorging on chips because we're waiting up because we really haven't eaten that much. Is there anything else you'd like to do to like improve the quality of this recording?
I don't know what you mean.
Like nobody can believe anything you're saying with your mustache.
Do you have them?
I don't have my glasses on me, otherwise I would drastically improve the quality of this recording.
Oh.
Would you have the squatters up?
Luis also got like three dinners.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah. The waiter actually went to him and said, this is a lot of food.
That's how you know you ordered correctly.
Well, this is dinner number one. We have a steak bowl here. Got a second thing coming. And Louis, this is after he ate like
a small appetizer.
A 1,000 calorie quesadilla.
What? A small appetizer.
Okay, 800 at least.
Minimum.
Well, you don't measure by calories.
Oh, just by how awesome it is?
That literally is how you measure food.
By size.
By size? What?
Yeah, size of calories.
Yeah. That was only like a small stick of butter, so it's like, it's not that many calories.
Well, it depends on why you're measuring. If you're measuring to see if he eats, like,
no,
way
like,
too much,
it'll
you
just
measure the amount of food, not the calories.
No, yeah.
No, that's
but,
totally wrong.
I mean, we're also talking about what's going to stick onto him after he eats all the food. So
not
if you
much,
eat.
Just like
oh my god, don't embarrass yourself, man.
I'm embarrassing you.
That's not, you're not, no, you're not.
So.
For those of you guys wondering, this was the deck that I played at the Grand Prix. Pretty sweet. It was a blue-red base. You know, we got some glare here, but a couple Burst Lightnings, Tribal Flames, Narcolepsy. It's just all removal. Double all his dust. Bane, Fire, and Repeal. So our spells were great. Creatures, medium. We had a Guildmage, Gust Skimmer, Dragon Soul Knight, Blinding Soul Eater, Edged Oracle. The worst card in my deck here was the Helium Squirter. And if I were to rebuild this deck, I'd probably replace that with maybe a Cloud Elemental. And the reason is, obviously this is not the type of card that you want in a control deck, but it's a card that's like a curve filler. It can block your opposing flyers, and it is a good evasive creature to turn on the Skargen Firebird. A lot of times I had a problem of, you know, having a Helium Squirt in play, but I can't actually get through because, you know, I have to pay a mana to give a creature flying. So, outside of that, I think it performed reasonably well. As you can see, I don't have a whole lot of fixing. Those are the only lands I had, but I had Forest, Plains, Swamp in my deck because I had two Tribal Flames, a Dimir Guildmage, and Dragon Soul Knight in my deck. So, a bit greedy, but when I drew my mana, it did do well.
Pod 1. The Hustle and Bustle.
That means you'll be
Okay.
Thank you very much. What are you doing here? You didn't make day 2. Not make day 2. Okay, where are we at here? Wow, 39.
Our whole league squad is here.
We are, our whole team. Go to Land Center rank 5s.
Yeah.
It's a lot more empty today, but I'm sure it'll fill up later on. Yeah. We made it just in the nick of time due to John Stocks' very, very aggressive driving, but managed to make it, so hopefully we open some money or a sweet rare. No, nothing in between. Nothing in between. No medium rare. Well, the dream is dead. I got quickly dismantled in the first round. I drafted actually a really, really solid green-white deck that I'll lay out later. I don't want everyone some spice to see. But yeah, it has 4 Sign of the Wilds, triple Scattered Seed, double Raise the Alarm, Wilt Leaf Leech, double Fortify, Overwhelm, double Nest Invader. It's got all the cards that you want to see in the token deck, but I had 0 removal spells, actual 0. I didn't see a single Arrest or Sunlance in the entire deck, or Blinding Soul Leaf. So because of that, you know, I was basically saying I can beat any fair deck, but I cannot beat any bombs. And the first round I played against a 5-color deck, who Savage Twisted all my tokens away game 1, and played a Hellkite Charger, and I was barely, I was unable to race him, so. Exit 3, gonna still play it out, but watch out pod 2, I'm gonna be rare drafting. So finished the first pod of the draft for this Grand Prix. Went 2-1. Lost the first round to a really good 5-color Savage Twister deck, which is actually 2-0 right now. But outside of that, I knew that, you know, if I just play with the deck, like against any other fair deck, my deck's gonna be pretty absurd because, like I said before, triple Scattered Seeds, Wilt Leaf Leech, double Nest Invader, double Raise the Alarm, Spectral Procession, and quadruple Scion of the Wild. So very, very linear green-white token strategy. So pretty happy to pick up 2 wins after the first loss. So 9-3 heading into the second pod. Hopefully I can open some Tarma Voice. All right, so just finished the first draft of the second draft pod, and I managed to beat Austin Bursevich. He had a really solid white affinity deck with double cranial plating. My deck, I'm not exactly sure if it's good or not, but it's an aggressive, almost mono black deck, splashing red for double burst lightning and a wrecking ball. And I just got really lucky because I opened both Bitter Blossom and Profane Commands. My plan is to just cast Bitter Blossom turn 2 every single game and ride that to victory. You know, that's what I ended up doing in the third game of our match. So, yeah, 10-3, still in contention for some cash, but out of top 8 contention. You know, maybe I'll finish extra and get 3 pro points. But outside of that, this tournament's been awesome. Just the whole scale of this tournament is unbelievable. And yeah, I'm just really, really glad to be a part of this. The only one downside is the fact that you can't find your friends ever. There's over 10,000 people here. It's really, really hard to find people unless you actually text them. And, you know, I'm always out of battery because I always forget to charge my phone. 2 more rounds to go. Let's see if we can get some cash money in our pockets. Managed 3-0 my last pod to finish 12-3 at the Grand Prix. Who knows how much I'm going to win, but you know, pretty happy with the results. It's going to get me 3 pro points, putting me at 35 on the year. So if I go X4-1 at the GP, I think I'll actually be able to make platinum. So that dream is still alive. And my deck wasn't great, but I did have some rares and I drew them a lot. So quickly just showing you guys the deck. We have a couple of last rares, a couple of burst lightning, actual card draw. These are my two drops.
Yes.
Triple Cathodian, double Grim Affliction. I had a lot of removal. Wrecking Ball, spread the sick mix. But honestly, there's this guy and those guys. Turns out these two are very good magic cards. So, man should take it down. So. GP Vegas was super fun. Gonna try to look for my friends. Luis was X2 going this last round, so hopefully he actually makes top 8. That would be awesome. But yeah, this format's great. I really, really look forward to streaming this format a lot over the next few weeks. Man, this GP was great. So somebody actually came up to me and, came up to me and was like, because of the help from, all the Modern Masters Seal practice that I did prior to Grand Prix, prior to this GP, it actually got him a top 8. So he shook my hand, I gave him a high five, and he said he actually top 8 because of my help. So that feels really awesome. Actually the highlight of my day. So, you know, that's kind of one of the goals that I have when I'm streaming is I want people to actually get better and improve. And somebody, and of course, even Webb, everybody's in on this, everybody. But it just felt really good to have somebody come up to me like that and, yeah, I wish him best of luck in the top 8. That feels really good. So here we are at the Las Vegas airport, on my way back home to see my beautiful wife and Kyle. Oh my goodness, missed the little rascal. It's been a really, really fun trip. It's been very, very awesome. Got to hang out with good friends, got to participate in the biggest Grand Prix of all time, and it was a spectacle. And had a pretty decent result. I finished 12-3, putting me at 62nd place. Yeah, normally 12-3 gets you top 16 at a lot of Grand Prix and like $500, but here I got $300 and got 62nd. Luis went 13-2 and got 17th. So just to give you guys an idea of the magnitude, how big this tournament was. Anyways, tournament was still a blast, had a lot of fun. Gives me 3 pro points, putting me at 35 pro points on the season, locking me for gold. So if I go to any Grand Prix from here on out, I will finally get my 3 buys. So that's a good feeling to know that I have 3 buys going into every tournament. Don't have to stress out about losing that third round and feel bad because I don't have the buy.
As a game change announcement for Southwest Airlines,
so it's Grand Prix Vegas.
That is the
35 points. I need 11 more points to try to get platinum for next season. That is the goal, and hopefully we can get it done.